finish Revelation and then Daniel 12. This is Revelation 21. And so we're picking up where the tape ran out. So there's a little bit of a break in, let's say, the continuity or energy flow or whatever that might be. But hopefully the track will be the same here. So we were on Mem and talking about the fact that in Revelation 21, verse 4, it says, nor mourning nor crying. So the Mem, which the letter itself means chaotic waters and bringing forth, birthing, exposing. When you cry or mourn, you're exposing your inner emotions, you might say, and it this chaotic waters, which are mourning and crying. So I'm showing here how each one of the letters, the meanings of each of these letters represented by the paleo format, more easily seen than those in the Hebrew, modern Hebrew format, because the paleo letters are shaped like the meanings of what they are, that the chronology of thought here, the sequencing of each line and each phrase in Revelation 21, 1 through 7, correlates, maps out to, follows the sequence of, on a one-to-one basis. I mean, it's exactly that. So here the Mem, nor mourning nor crying, that phrase is a Mem concept. The next phrase, and there shall be no pain, lines up with the noon. Well, the noon is the letter for fish, they say, or life imparted, or life quickened, or suddenly imparted and coming to be, but it's also like a tree that once it's born, once the seed breaks open, it puts out roots, it puts out branches, it grows up, its nutrients are supplied to it so that it starts growing up unto its, you might say, adult stage, where it starts doing what it's supposed to do, which is bearing fruit or bearing shade or whatever it is that tree is all about doing. So, which is, again, the position of the psalmic. So this place of the noon is in between the birth and the doing of what you're called to do. You might say this is the apprentice stage or the place of branching out, gaining, developing, sprouting. So, and there shall be no more pain. We're talking about the renewed heaven and the renewed earth. And so what is the fact that there shall be no more pain have to do with this? Well, it's the learning process, which is painful, you know, trial and error, school of hard knocks, the growth, development of any person as they're going through adolescence, as their bones are stretching and they're, you know, strengthening their muscles and they're trying to learn the right thing and they're struggling and going to school. There's a painful process of becoming. And not only that, but just even as we walk our daily life, the pain that we suffer for making errors of our way and being corrected, or being find ourselves falling short and having to readjust and make amends and apologize. I mean, this life that we live now is painful. And he says, listen, in this new life there's going to be no pain. And it has to do with the when he brings us forth into this new place, the life process is not going to be painful the way it is now. So here again, for the sake of seeing this alphabet sequence, it might say laid over these verses of Revelation 21, it causes there, at least for me, it causes there to be a different way of looking at a significant meaning of each one of these phrases. If I associate the phrase, there shall be no more pain, with any other letter, I could construe a symbolic meaning, associative meaning to that. The fact that this happens to line up with the noon makes me go with this particular explanation. So for the next letter, for the former matters have passed away, lines up with the psalmic. And what I'm saying it lines up with that is because with each phrase, which is a change of thought, like if you have a wheel and there's different cogs on the wheel, and that wheel is turning incrementally, sequentially, one cog at a time, every time there's a change of thought, a change of perspective, change of nuance, it's like this is the wheel with the 22 letters and you're moving ahead one more cog, one more letter. So you could say no mourning, nor crying. Well, those are two cogs. But in thinking of the chaotic waters, because they have the line of the mem, I'm just calling that as being one cog. And there shall be no more pain goes on to the next one. That's a whole different concept. And then for the former matters have passed away is another concept, so that jumps up to the next cog, you might say, which is the samech. So what is the samech? Well, the samech is lines up with the fourth day of creation, where he put sun, moon, and stars in the sky to be appointed for times and seasons. The word for seasons is moedim. Moedim is the festivals, represented again by the articles of the tabernacle. But these present matters for orchestrating time, for orchestrating due process, the spring feast again when Yeshua came the first time, the fall feast when he's coming back, the reference we have for the sequence of our regard of his ways throughout the year, the Moedim, regard of his ways meaning the Mishkan pattern is his ways, and as we walk through the festivals throughout the year, Pesach, Chag Matzot, Shavuot, Yom Teruah, Yom Kippur, Sukkot, Shemini Atzeret, or in English, Passover, Unleavened Bread, Pentecost, which is actually Greek, count 50, Feast of Weeks, Day of Blowing of Trumpets, Day of Atonement, Feast of Tabernacles, and the Eighth Gathering. As we walk through the year doing these things, we are doing his ways because these are his commanded assemblies. And these are a prototype, they're shadows of things to come. So as we're doing that, we're orchestrating our life in harmony, in congruity with his ways, his processes, his formulative revelation, formulative meaning that there's a form specified to it, a form and a sequence and a series of steps. And we could sit here and say, well, how do we regard his ways? How do we keep his ways? Well, there's the Ten Commandments. Okay, don't do this and make sure I do that. Well, that's one way. And then, of course, Yeshua said the greatest commandment is to love Yahweh or Elohim. And, well, how do we do that? Well, is that a heart assent? Certainly. But how then shall our heart reveal its assent? Which is to say, play it out in our visible actions, which is our words and our deeds, in our manner of relating to one another, in the disposition of our inner sentiment, which is portrayed or betrayed, as the case may be, in our words, in our facial expressions, in our attitudes, in our just a little bit of a slack we might give to somebody or holding somebody accountable. I mean, all these various expressions revealing the inner self is ways to do that, but it's doing that, meaning to do what he said to do. But it's also keeping the Sabbath day and walking out the festivals, because again, if the festivals are architectural references, object references to the letters of the alphabet, if the letters of the alphabet are the 22 designated aspects of revealing his character, nature, inclination, preference, desire, then as we walk out the festivals, I have made this personal, you might say arbitrary, though I think it's specific, not arbitrary, association between the Mishkan big white fence with these three letters. The altar sacrifice with those two letters. The labor with those two letters. And then these letters, one-to-one, Samech to the menorah, table of showbread to the ayin, altar of incense to the pei, and the Ark of the Covenant to the Zadik, and then the pillar of fire that came up over, and I'm projecting this way, because if this is a flat plane, like you're looking down on the Mishkan, the pillar of fire would be coming this way, coming out from the Ark of the Covenant, which is what the kuf would represent, this pillar of fire spreading up, and then like the pillar of cloud spreading out over, giving shade to the whole Mishkan. So the point is, because this is what he has determined to reveal to us of himself and to ask us to walk in as regarding him and his ways, he then provided these, if you count the Shabbat, these eight festivals to actually be doing these things. And so as we regard the Festival of Unleavened Bread, we're regarding actually the concepts behind the kaf and the lamed. As we regard Pesach, we're actually doing something about the het, the tet, and the yod, as we acknowledge, and the question is, well, now how do you acknowledge that? That's a whole other question, but the fact that we do acknowledge it, we're somehow doing, we're walking through the mem and the nun. So anyway, to go back to Revelation here, the summit, for the former matters have passed away. You could say, well, wait a minute, which former matters? These former matters? Well, he said Aleph Tav is unto eternity. He was and is to come. So it's not these matters which are done and be done away with in the new kingdom. It's not these matters. So for people to say, well, the ceremonial law was done away with when Yeshua died on the cross. It's like, well, what's the ceremonial law? Are you talking about the festivals? Those are under eternity. They map out to the alphabet, directly correlated to it, and the alphabet is the revelation of the Aleph Tav. Yeshua is the Aleph Tav. Did Yeshua do away with himself when he died on the cross? These matters, he said, regard these things throughout all your generations forever. But if they were simply a festive gathering with some sort of ritualistic association, we might think that they could be done away with because, well, what do we need them anymore once Yeshua, the one who they speak of, is in our midst? Well, these speak as much as him being in our midst as him in bodily form or him by his spirit, his ruach, in our midst, because they're all him. I would suggest that these festivals are somehow him in our midst and us in him as we're keeping the festivals. I mean, it goes way beyond simply having a holiday. And when he says the former matters have passed away, he's already qualifying what those former matters are. Mourning, crying, pain, death, tears, and the fact that he doesn't seem to be dwelling with us the way that he's going to be then. Those are the former matters that have passed away. He's already qualified it in the verses right before that. Then the next phrase, and he who is sitting on the throne said, see, I make all new. Well, the ayin is an I. It's also like a deep well, deep understanding. And because the ayin correlates to the table of showbread in this Mishkan model, that table of showbread was the word for faces. Panim means faces, the word for showbread. And it maps out to Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement. And so there's this balancing on the Day of Atonement, and there's also the ayin also represents the balance between judgment and mercy. If we receive his mercy, we're not going to incur his judgment. If we don't get his mercy, then the full judgment is on us. Why do we get his mercy? Because of the blood of Yeshua. If we're not under the blood of Yeshua, if we haven't received the blood of Yeshua to cleanse us from all sin, our sin bears on us, and on judgment day we will suffer the weight of that judgment upon us because we are not taking advantage of the mercy offered to us, which is the blood of Yeshua, his blood to wash away all our sins because he atoned for it. Hence the Day of Atonement. So the when he says, I make all new, see, I make all new, he's saying, see. Now, when the Almighty says, let there be, then it happens. When he says, see, your eyes are open. So he's actually imparting vision to us by saying the word see. It's not a rhetorical statement like look, it's not a word in passing. It's a, everything he says is a commanding authority to create, to cause to be. So when he says, see, I make all things new. If we choose to receive that, we can receive it because he's already said it. Yeshua said, whatever you ask for according to my Father's will, believe that you've received it when you ask for it, and you will receive it according to your faith, according to your belief. And so I could sit here and say, gee, how do I understand this? He commanded me to see. If I choose to see, now I can, because he's already expressed his preference, which is that I see. He even commanded it to be. So the question is, do we resist that command and say, well, it's impossible to see, it's impossible to understand? I've heard people who say they're believers tell me in their own words, it's impossible to understand. Or I've even had someone say, you couldn't handle the truth even if it was shown to you. Well, that's in defiance of this. If he tells me to see, what's he going to show me? The truth. Therefore, the burden is his to cause me to handle what he gives me if I yield to him. So to say I couldn't handle it is a bit of a misstatement. Of my own strength, probably not. Of my own volition, probably not. Of my own integrity, probably not. But this has nothing to do with me. This is him. If he says, see, I make all new, then I will receive that sight in Yeshua's name. Anyway, to go on. The next sentence, how it lines up with the pay, is he says, which is a mouth, an altar of incense. The other places in Scripture say that the prayers of the saints are like this sweet-smelling savor that goes up unto him. The altar of incense represents the prayers of the saints, but it also represents the mind of Yeshua, which is where he is speaking to us. He reveals his mind to us. As we, I believe it was, I'm not sure if it got on the tape or not, so I'll reiterate, that there are those who are aware of spiritual things, powers and principalities and demons and the workings of the devil in the spiritual realm, and that is this ocular position of the ocular. The occult means vision. So I mentioned the word binocular. The word bein, bet yod nun, Strong's number 995, has to do with thinking and processing, contemplating, reasoning, meditating, just really getting in there and deciding, because it's actually translated as the word between. So binocular, you might say between vision, but it's actually the word for two. Bi, like bicycle, right? Binocular is two visions, two eyeglasses, but it all has to do with what's between. Between implies two. So here we have people, to get better understanding of what they're looking at, they use binoculars. I'm making word associations here for you to see kind of what's going on here. But the point is that people that want to see into the spiritual realm, we can look at this another way. This is where the stars, the fourth day, where stars, sun and moon were put in the sky. So he put in time. Well, that time is a dimension. Some people say it's the fourth dimension. So you have the three dimensions of physical matter, and then you have the fourth dimension of time, and then there's another dimension beyond time, which is like the spiritual realm, seeing the things that are working behind time and space, you might say, which would be this realm. So the people who are aware of spiritual things, and then you get various other theories on what is really going on. So people search out astrology, people search out other mighty ones, other gods, other systems that may be at work behind the physical universe to cause things to exist, or to cause things to be, or to cause things to act, forces to act on. So you get people who are into maybe chanting certain things, or using certain scents, or using certain mantras, or using certain potions or certain hexes. They're trying to influence the physical world by mechanisms of reaching their hand into the invisible world and forcing their will to come about on the surface of the earth. They're trying to gain their strength from this position. Though those things may have effect, and though they may be true to some extent, they're limited in that what we have access to, who believe in Yeshua, is him telling us. We have this pay, this mouth, the mind of Yeshua speaking to us. And he says, have nothing to do with the things of the occult. Have nothing to do with magicians and sorcerers and witchcraft and magic. So as I mentioned earlier on this tape, which we'll reiterate right now because this is the next day, that sequence of the Mishkan pattern of who does not get into the kingdom is drug sorcery, which lines up with this, which lines up with that, which lines up with the hidden mysteries, which if you try to, and I'm not sure what ended up on this tape or not, so this may be redundant, but anyway, if we try to pillage the kingdom for our own purposes, for our own gain, for our own self-seeking clout, to implement our will upon others or upon circumstances for our own gain, that's sorcery. Even if you do it with the name Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, even if you do it with the letters of the Hebrew alphabet, even if you do it with Bible verses, it's one thing to seek the face of the Almighty. It's one thing to seek the being of the one who's referenced by the name, but to try to use the name to accomplish your goals, your purposes, is idolatrous, is sorcery. We ought to be careful what we're doing and why we're doing it and how we're doing it, so as to not fall into that camp, though we think we're doing rightly. And the way to do that is to regard his words and just to communicate with him present tense. So it goes on to, in the position of the pay, it says, and he said to me, write, for these words are true and trustworthy. So here this phrase in the book of Revelation 21, verse 5, it's now, this next phrase is talking about words and saying and writing. That's different than the one before it, which is having to do with see, and different than the one before it that had to do with establishing times and more matters and sequences and different things. So I'm showing you that there's a valid correlation here. Anyway, one other thing regarding these three that we didn't talk about before, which I'll throw in with Micah 6:8, he has shown you, O man, what is good and what Elohim requires of you. Do justly, like the psalmist, which is to, that's our responsibility. Love mercy, that's with what heart we do what we are responsible to do. And walk humbly with your Elohim. How do you walk humbly with your Elohim? You talk with him. And you talk with one another. It all has to do with the mouth, with eating, with breathing, with fellowship, with discussing. So these three work in this triad of association. How do you do justly? It's defined by and referenced by the other two. You love mercy and walk humbly with your Elohim. That defines how you do justly. How do you walk humbly with your Elohim? You do justly and love mercy. If you do those two things and talk to him about it, you'll be walking with him. How do you love mercy? Well, do justly and walk humbly with your Elohim. Talk to him about it. So each one I can see is accomplished by the doing of the other two. If you talk to him and try to do justly, you will end up loving, not loving mercy as an attitude of your heart. You can prefer mercy. You can desire. If you're given an, there was a situation, I'll give this little story, I've told it before, but for the sake of this tape. There was an occasion, myself and a friend drove up to park and do some work outside of a commercial building, some little repair work, and we were talking about something, and this other fellow parked next to me, who also worked on the building, made just a really rude comment. Just, we didn't speak to him, we didn't have anything to do with him, and he just said, keep it down, nobody wants to hear it. Just like, and I noticed at the time that what he said incited a violent reaction of my disposition against him. But I wasn't going to do anything to him, because what I'm out here, actually, I was in the parking lot of my brother's office, and I'm not going to defile my brother's integrity by getting in a physical altercation or even a verbal conflict with this guy who works for the building right out here in the parking lot. But I sure felt like it. And I noticed that had we had this other person who had been working with us present that day, in a matter of moments, there would have been a physical battle going on in that moment. This guy would not have tolerated it, and they would have been, he would have been punching his lights out within a few seconds. That's the way this other guy is. But I sure felt like it. And I thought, and I looked, and I saw that he was parked in the handicap zone. I thought, you know, there's a police station right on the other side of this building. I could call up the police station and say, hey, could you come and ticket this guy? He would never know it was me. And boy, I could sure get him. And then the concept, the provocation was there, the occasion was there, and I would be justified in doing it. But the concept came, love mercy. He doesn't deserve mercy. But if he deserved it, it wouldn't be mercy. So I thought, I'm not going to do it. Because now I have an occasion to be merciful. And if I prefer mercy, then I will be glad for this occasion that could have been otherwise for me to actually give this person mercy. Though he has no regard of it, though he doesn't know it, though he still has a stupid, rotten attitude and going about his ways, he doesn't know what just happened. He doesn't know how he just got saved. His insurance would have gotten up, he would have gotten a ticket, he would have had a bad day, on and on and on, the repercussions of what might have happened to him had I chosen, yeah, he deserves this. But I chose mercy. I thought of this verse. Love mercy. Look for the occasions to do mercy. And it's done by the heart, the desire to do justly and walk humbly with our Maker, our Elohim. And then there's this other verse from the Beatitudes which ties into that. Remember, with the measure you use will be measured to you. What if I, by accident or by oversight or by being in a hurry, parked in a handicapped zone one of these days, sooner or later, I would deserve the same type of mercy that I just extended to him? So the point we're making yesterday is that we ought to regard, as we do these things, we don't know why they're happening. But with the measure we use, it'll be measured to us, certainly. And therefore, if I had called the cops on him, then some other day in the future, when I do something and somebody calls the cops on me, I had nobody but to blame but myself, because that's the measure I determined. Anyway, that's the way Micah 6:8 plays into the association of these three in a brief description. Anyway, then the Zadok position. The next phrase, Revelation 21 says, and he said to me, it is done. I am the Aleph and the Tav, the beginning and the end. Well, Yeshua, when he's hanging on the cross, said, it is finished. It's one of the last words he spoke. There's an association there. The Zadok, as we discussed earlier, the word Zadok means righteous. Yeshua is the righteous one. There's another verse elsewhere that says he will rule with a rod of iron, and his scepter is this rod of iron. And what would his scepter look like? I mean, I can kind of imagine his scepter maybe looking like the Zadok. It's a fish hook, but it's also the symbol of the word righteous. And then he says, I am the Alpha and the Tau, the beginning and the end. And again, I'm not sure if we discussed this the other day or not, but the word for Holy of Holies, which is a King James word, is the most set apart place. But there's also a word where the most set apart Holy of Holies place was also called the Debir, which is the Word. And Yeshua, of course, is the Word made flesh, the Word incarnate. And you can say, well, what is the Word? Well, all words are made up of these 22 alphabet letter words. And the book, the covers of the book, you might say, are Aleph and Tav, because all words are made out of these words here. So I would suggest that the Word is Aleph Tav. The Word is everything that Aleph Tav represents and everything that Aleph Tav means, which is the covenant, which is everything he had planned to do, said he was going to do, will bring about doing and accomplish doing just as he planned. That Word is the intention and purpose and accomplishment of the preferences and desires and strategies, but it's more than a strategy. It's the strategic implementation of his purposes brought into reality. That's Aleph and Tav. All in Yeshua, all in the Torah, and that same thing's intended to be in us, as the Hay, as the Holy Spirit, as the Ruach, causing us, leading us, encouraging us to walk in these very same ways, which is why if Yeshua kept the festivals, then we should keep the festivals, which means they can't be done away with, because we're supposed to look just like him. He came doing what his word said to do in the Torah, and therefore, him being the model of all things we are to be and do, we should be doing the same things. Anyway, for him to say, I am the Aleph and the Tav, we talked also yesterday that the eighth day, the eighth festival, the phrase Shemini Atzeret, is actually the seventh festival. If you count the Shabbat, it's eight, but the Shabbat is a set apart festival, and then these are the festival of the Moedim. So the seventh is actually, the word means fulfilled. The eight, that word, that letter, the number, connotates new beginnings. Well, new beginnings is like the first, and being fulfilled is the last. So here you have this paradox of the first and the last being the same. Well, the Aleph is the first, and the Tav is the last, and they're the same. So he says, I'm the Aleph and Tav, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, like the Shemini Atzeret. This is all a reference to him saying, this is me. And he then is the model by which we are to reference how we do these three things. That's why this triangle of is pointing to him. That's why this blue triangle, we have the blue thread in the tzitzit that he said to wear. And so you remember all I told you, so that you will do what I said to do, so that you will be blessed and not cursed. And what do you say to do? Righteousness, which is why this is colored blue and why that's colored blue, like the blue tzitzit thread, which all has to do with his ways. Remember that he is the creator. He made this place. He, by his grace, told us what he made and how he made it. Hence his royal decrees purple. And then he manifests it in the flesh in Yeshua, hence the color red. And so Yeshua, doing what the creator said, the combination of red and blue is the purple. It's another way the colors play out. And as we do what he said, we are walking out his righteousness. And so the white linen was a metaphorical picture of the righteousness of the saints. And there's a basic doctrine that says, well, righteousness is imparted to us. It's not what we do. That's true. However, he said, do these things. And he said, obedience is better than sacrifice. It would be better that we obeyed him rather than bringing sacrifices to say, gee, oops, I'm sorry for not doing what you said. And so as we simply do what he said, those are righteous actions, because Yeshua was favored by his father, who said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased, because he did what he was told to do. He did what he saw his father doing. He said what he heard his father saying. If Yeshua did rightly and so was righteous, and he says, now follow me and do rightly as I do rightly, that doesn't mean I'm claiming my own righteousness. I'm just walking in the footsteps of the righteous one. I am doing the righteous things that the righteous one said to do as unto glorifying his Father. So for us to say we can do righteously is not to profane the fact that we are only righteous because of his blood, or that that righteousness is imparted unto us. Of course it's imparted unto us. That's what the letter Nun means. But the letter Nun, it's imparted unto us so that we can do justly. To say that we can't do justly or that we can't do righteously is actually to deny the implication of what these letters are saying is our obligation. And then it becomes a semantical conversation to try to say, well, how much is expected of us and required of us, and which doctrine are you in contention with, to say everything we have and everything we are is just because we're covered by the blood and has nothing to do with me. I would say that this differs from that, but that's a whole other conversation. Anyway, he said the words are trustworthy and true, and he's the Aleph and Tav, the beginning of the end. And then as an overview, which is like this pillar of fire, like I said, that gives you an overview of the whole thing, he says, to the one who thirsts, I shall give of the fountain of the water of life without payment. So, in a way, this is the letter I guess I was looking at. It's kind of like a fountain concept. The letter Kuf is the back of the head. It means after this, that which comes later or the least. It also is like the shape of an ornament, like around your neck and a pendant hanging, so that it also means ornament. But it's also kind of like a fountain, that which is like shooting up and spreading out over. So there's something about then the concept of the shape of the letter, where we get our letter Q, and that has to do with this concept. The overview of this whole thing is that to the one who thirsts, to the one who chooses to come to the kingdom of heaven and hungers and thirsts after righteousness and wants to be clean and wants to learn his ways and wants to be put on the potter's wheel. You can almost see this as a potter's wheel. I think we mentioned in his hand then is put to us to shape us into his vessel. The one who desires and prefers him to engage our lives by these things, he will give of the fountain of the water of life. Yeshua said, whoever thirsts, let him come to me, and I will give him a drink. And as he gives that drink to us, that drink becomes in us this fountain of living water, this geyser coming forth from us to give drink to whoever else wants a drink. Goes on to the resh. The resh is the lifted up, the exalted man, the glorified man, the esteemed man. So you got Yeshua ben David when he comes back and he shows his face as the exalted one, as contrasted to Yeshua ben Joseph, the common man, the basic man, the exalted man. So, to the exalted man, to the one who overcomes shall inherit all this, and I shall be his Elohim, and he shall be my son. The exalted man, the one who he says, this is my son. This is available to us. Each one of these letters represents Yeshua. Each one of these letters represents the covenant. Each one of these letters represents the Torah. Each one of these letters represents his plan for why is the world created. Each letter represents what he expects of us, but also each letter represents our obligation unto him. And each letter represents a promise to us of what his heart is for what he will give us. And we could go through each letter in each of those aspects and discuss that. But this is taking it right out of Scripture and showing how each sequential phrase and concept throughout this particular Scripture corresponds to the letter in sequence and its meaning. So this one we get to, the one who overcomes will inherit all this. Yeshua is coming back and says, everything I have was given to me by my Father, and everything I have I give to you. He's the firstborn among many, many brethren, and a double portion of the inheritance, obviously, the scriptures say go to the firstborn, but Yeshua said, everything I have I give to you. You're mine. That's what we have to look forward to when we see his face, that we'll be made like him. And then it goes on to the sheen, the consuming fire, the essence and character and nature, the nurturing one, El Shaddai, but also the consuming teeth of destruction. And this next sentence says, as this we discussed earlier, but as for the cowardly, and I'll just point to these again, these words relate to the Mishkan pattern because there's a specific sequence there, who does not get into the kingdom. But as for the cowardly, those afraid to approach, the untrustworthy, those who will not handle his name with the regard that they ought to, the abominable, those who do not regard his instructions, the murderers, this is the day that he spoke life into the earth, those who, this is the day that represents the covenants of promise that give us life, and the murderers are those who take life, so this is the antithesis of each one of these things, those who whore, which is to say, he's the vine, we're the branches, we're supposed to be grafted in, and those who are grafted into some other mighty one, or those who profane their covenant with him to go wandering waywardly with, frolicking with some other mighty one, the drug sorcerers, those whose heart is on personal gain from the powers of the occult, the idolaters, those who, though they may say the word God, they may say the name of God, it's a different God. It's a different Jesus. It's a different Yeshua. Because who is he? We must know the one who we speak to. It's the one described by each one of these letters. And all the false. This is the covenants of This is the covenant. This is the Ten Commandments put inside the Ark of the Covenant. This is the standard of righteousness. Anything contrary to that standard of righteousness is false. Those who suppose they line up with all these other things, but yet deny this standard of righteousness, are the false. And then the Tav, as a conclusionary statement, their part is in the lake which burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. That was the alphabet pattern showing Revelation 21. So here's the Mishkan pattern with the same exact sentences and same sequence. I'll just kind of breeze through this, and hopefully it'll be self-explanatory to a certain extent. And I saw a renewed heaven and a renewed earth, and the former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea is no more. That's like, okay, this is where we're starting. This is the slate washed clean. Here we are about to engage what the new thing is. This is Vav, number for man, number for the bridge, number for the seven, the number for being cut off. This is cut off. We're now going towards a new beginning. Eight. And I, Yohanan, saw the set apart city, renewed Yerushalayim, coming down out of the heaven from Elohim, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. It's like the tabernacle itself, representational of this city coming down. The altar of sacrifice, the revelation of his ways, the Torah, Kafan, the Lamed, the covering, the authority. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, see, the Sukkah of Elohim is with men, and he shall dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and Elohim himself shall be with them, and be their Elohim. So here before I said that there was four letters which lined up with that phrase, the He, the Vav, the Zayin, and the Het, and the Tet, five letters. But in this other sequence of reasoning, sequential process, it all lines up with that. In that, his instructions are his voice proclaiming that he wants to dwell with us and that we should be his people. How should we be his people? Regard his instructions. The Sukkah of Elohim is with man. Who is the Sukkah of Elohim? Yeshua. Sukkah meaning tabernacle, meaning abode, meaning tent, meaning like this earth body that we have, which we dwell in on the face of the earth. He came down, he took on the body to be with us, and he did what the instructions said to do. That's why we know that's who he was. He's the only guy that could accurately keep all the commandments. And Elohim shall wipe away from their tears, shall wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, no mourning, no crying, and there shall be no more pain, for the former matters have passed away. And he who is sitting on the throne said, see, I make all new. And he said to me, write, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said, it is done. I am the Alpha and Tav, beginning and the end. To the one who thirsts, I shall give of the fountain of the water of life without payment. The one who overcomes shall inherit all this. And I shall be his Elohim, and he shall be my son. And then this, speaking of the hope set before us, the rest of that, but as for the cowardly, the untrustworthy, the abominable, and murderers, and those who whore, and drug sorcerers, and idolaters, and all the false, their part is in the lake which burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. So here, this is your reward. Depending on how you balance out on the day of judgment, day of atonement, you end up with this future or that future. Anyway, I cut this a little bit shorter than the other day, but we should go into Daniel 12. The point about Daniel 12 is that we also see the alphabet in the sequence of the words. And this thing here is the, almost like the capstone or the quintessential or the epitome of proof, evidence if not proof anyway, that these things are pertinent and significant and worthy of regard, real. So it says here, verse 3, this is the last chapter of Daniel, and Daniel had already lived his life. He was getting pretty old at this point. He'd had a number of visions. He'd interpreted a number of visions. This angel shows up to him and shows him yet another one, and this is what he said. The wise will shine like the radiance of the firmament, and those who teach righteousness to the multitudes will shine like the stars forever and ever. Teach what righteousness? Yeshua, the righteous one. What is righteousness? Well, what was in the Ark of the Covenant? The covenant. What's the covenant? This whole thing is the covenant. How do you teach righteousness? You teach this. You teach Yeshua. You teach the Aleph Tav. You teach what this means. The gospel, the Torah. Those who teach the Torah, those who teach the gospel, those who teach righteousness to the multitudes will shine like the stars forever and ever. And this relates to this here. The wise will shine like the stars. Well, this is the day that he put the stars in. Who are the wise? Those with the understanding that he's imparted the wisdom to and who's chosen to behave and respond in appropriate regard of it. And those who teach righteousness, that's speaking. Teaching what? Righteousness. It's all about righteousness. The wise doing what he said to do and teaching righteousness, all of teaching Yeshua, this is where we're called to live. This is his plan. This is the common world seeing Yeshua on the cross. This is him molding us according to his ways and equipping us to do this. This is where we're supposed to be living, expressing righteousness. Those who do that will shine like the stars forever and ever. As for you, Daniel, obscure the matters and seal the book until the time of the end. This says, let many muse and let knowledge increase. This is the Tanakh. The other scriptures say, many shall run to and fro and knowledge shall increase. Another version says, and many shall seek diligently and knowledge shall increase. So I'll show you here that this is a key self-embedded in a code explaining this, which is a message to the people at the end of time. Obscure the matter and seal the book until the time of the end. I wrote this out. This is what this says in Hebrew written in the Paleo. Until the time of the end. Ayin Dalet, Ayin Tav means until the time. Ayin Dalet means a witness. It means a testifier, like in a legal case. It's a period of duration. Hence they get the word until as an English word in reference to it. Ayin Tav is a length of that duration, until the time of. So, is another interesting note towards this, the Moedim is Mem, Ayin, Dalet, Moed, and then plural, Yod, Mem, but the Moed is to bring forth the witness. So the Moedim are the festivals. The festivals are the bringing forth of the witness of the Creator's ways and timings and sequences. So here we have Ayin Dalet, Ayin Tav. The word for the Garden of Eden, the word Eden is actually spelled Ayin Dalet Nun. Well, if you look at the modern Hebrew, you just read this as Ayin Dalet, Ayin Tav, in my mind, just tries to translate what that means. But if I look at it in the Paleo, my mind is affected differently, and I see that this basically says, understand the door, understand the covenant. It's a catch 22. There's 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. So here if you define the Hebrew alphabet by defining and showing Yeshua, who said, I am the door, each letter says who Yeshua is, who is the Messiah. And what does he expect of us, and what is he going to do? It's the covenant. Well, the Tav is the sign of the covenant. To understand the covenant is to understand Yeshua. To understand Yeshua is to understand the covenant. If you think Yeshua is a Jesus person who said that the Sabbath day doesn't matter, that the festivals don't matter, that the instructions don't matter, that being set apart from the world doesn't matter, that's not the same as Yeshua the Messiah, who says these things are all incredibly significant and do matter, and are necessary and important and will remain until the end of this time and beyond, because this is him, and he doesn't change from the past, the present, or the future. Therefore, these things will remain, and how can anybody who claims to be him say that they don't matter? It's the evidence that they're not him. The point is, to understand the covenant is to understand Yeshua. To understand Yeshua is to see the covenant, and you realize the two are inseparable. Therefore, if Daniel was told to hide the words and seal the book until the time of the end, the question is, where's the book, and what words did he seal and hide? And so I would maintain that this is it. Approximately 500 BC is when, from the best I can find, is when the language was changed from Paleo to modern. So at that time, Ezra and Nehemiah brought the modern script back to Jerusalem when they came out of the Jews came out of Babylonian captivity. At that time, they had forgotten, forsaken the covenant. They had done away with everything, which is everything of the truth that they were handed to regard and to give to the world, which is, other than the profaning the land covenant and not regarding the Sabbath, is for the land, for farming, is one reason why they're sent into captivity. The point is, they had already turned away from the covenant. Ezra and Nehemiah come back with the modern script, which is actually an Aramaic style. It's not, you might say, indigenous Hebrew. It's borrowed from the northern culture, which is where Assyria was, which is one of their enemies. So for the some Jewish people that I've talked to basically say they have no regard for this Paleo because the Canaanites were using it. But the fact that the Canaanites were using it, because they were the inhabitants of the land where this was actually indigenous, doesn't necessarily mean this is profane. It just means that somebody else who had access to it disregarded it and profaned it and turned it into icons regarding the creation rather than the creator, which is the same problem that we have to this day. To annihilate the original letters and make them this other letter isn't anything more sacred, but I would suggest that it was Daniel who changed it because he was a contemporary of 500 BC of Ezra and Nehemiah, and he is the one that was commanded and told to hide the words and seal the book until the time of the end. How would he do that? Where's the book and where are these words? I would suggest that these are the words. And the book is, the word for book is sefer, which is samech, pei, resh. It's the same word that Abraham was told to go out and sefer the stars, count the stars, number the stars. But it's also a word that is not just count number, but it's narrate or tell a story. Or like a barber might cut wild hair and give it a shape, to set a boundary, establish a frontier. All these words are what the word sefer means. There's a certain a concept, the sephirotic tree, which looks like a constellation. There's these 10 spheres connected with lines, showing the relationship of the character aspects, you might say, of the Almighty. And kind of looks like a constellation. So, if he was told to seal the connections between the dots, if you looked at all these 22 letters as, you might say, dots of a constellation, something that tells a story, and he was saying, he was told, obscure that. How do you do that? You somehow erase the lines that make the connections. By changing the letters, that's what's happened over the last 2,500 years, is that the connections between the dots have been obscured, so now we see independent dots, independent letters with phonetic sounds, but no connections between them. So the point is, if this was indeed Daniel who changed the lettering from the Paleo to the modern, the question is, who else would have done this? No one had the authority. Ezra was a scribe, he had to copy the letters exactly. Nehemiah was a governor, he had no authority to muck around with the language of the Kadosh, the set apart. So the question is, how do we know this came from, how do we know whether Hebrew or the Paleo Hebrew was the original language? Well, what letters, what writing style did the Almighty One, Yahweh, use to write on the tables of stone? I can't prove that it was the Paleo, but the point is this. If the sequence of the days of the week of creation, as we discussed earlier, correspond to the letters. And if the sequence of the days of creation correspond to the tabernacle, and if the tabernacle was in heaven and the heavens and earth were created that first week, and if the plan had to be conceived, determined, and implemented before the implementation of the plan could, which is a logical, reasonable, and if the implementation of the plan was the creation of the seven-day week, then it seems to me an obvious conclusion that the calibration between, the relationship between the alphabet letters and the Mishkan, the alphabet letters and the sequence of the days of the week, it had to happen at the same time, or that the alphabet letters, which were the plan, the covenant, the Aleph Tav, Isaiah 14:24, as he planned, so it shall be, as he purposed, so it shall come about, the days of creation were a manifestation of what he already determined, which was the alphabet letters in Hebrew. Therefore, this Hebrew alphabet had to pre-exist the creation of the world. And the representation of the letters in glyphic, which is to say iconic or structured form for the letters to represent their meanings, such as this, would either have to be in this particular type of paleo font, rather than an obscure font, which has no particular meanings, like these up here, or some other thing with the equal association. In other words, if the psalmic wasn't drawn exactly like this, it still meant what that psalmic means, and it was still a psalmic. If the noon wasn't drawn exactly like this, it had to be drawn similarly to imply its meaning. Therefore, the creation was made according to the alphabet. Therefore, this alphabet is the one piece of archaeological substance that we have, which is the most ancient of anything that exists on the face of the earth, because it predated the existence of the universe and the earth itself. Therefore, this had to be the original language that he talked to Adam and Hua with in the Garden of Eden. And this had to be the language that they spoke up until the days of Noah. This had to then be the language that they spoke until the time of the Tower of Babel. And since no other language exists like Hebrew other than Hebrew, this was the one language which maintained its integrity throughout all time up until now. It's logical, reasonable extraction. But if somebody disagrees, then let them reason their own way to otherwise. The point is, I'm not saying this with the authority of divine revelation. I'm saying it seems reasonable to me. Point of the matter is, if Daniel was told to hide these matters, what else would be the provocation to change from the paleo, which was the finger of the Almighty written on the tables of stone, if such is the case, to be the modern? What was lost? The meanings of the letters, according to the covenant, according to the revelation of Yeshua. That's what was lost. The meanings of the letters here are still the same as here, but they're slightly different. As we talked yesterday, ox, house, camel, door, nail, or window, nail, weapon, fence, basket, hand, wing, shepherd's staff, water, fish, prop, eye, mouth, fish hook, back of the head, head, teeth, mark. I don't see the covenant there. I don't see Yeshua there. But from what we're just talking about, I do. So the point is this. How does that have to do with Daniel? Ayin Dalet Ayin Tav, until the time. Kuf Zadik is the next word, the end. And so this is the next sentence written in the Paleo Hebrew of the words that mean, for many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Just for the sake of reference, if you look at the Tanakh, this word, which means end, this word means many, this word means increase, this word means knowledge, And this word means, I believe, run to and fro. Run to and fro many and increase knowledge, the knowledge. Well, depending on how you translate that in English, that's why you get three or four different definitions. And so if we want to hang on every literal word and say, potentially, how do they get this out of that? Let me show you something behind, then, another way to interpret this. And so the question is, out of all the years that anybody's ever heard Daniel 12 discussed, in this phrase, for many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase, what does that mean? Well, we've got a lot of vehicles these days, cars, trains, airplanes, boats, spaceships. We're running all the way around the world, to and fro, into outer space, and knowledge increase, high-tech stuff, but is that what he's referring to? Perhaps. That might make this the time of the end. But what else might make this the time of the end? Here in Daniel 12, I would suggest that this is a key within us, a code that has its key embedded in it. I understand that there was a spaceship that we sent off into the far side of the galaxy, and there was a binary code printed on it, and the key to the code NASA put so that any person, say, really intelligent life, might look at this and find that the key to interpreting the code was actually in the code itself. If they had even the slightest degree of intelligence, they ought to be able to figure that out. That's what's going on here. I'll point this out to you. The concept here, as for you, Daniel, this is Daniel 12, verse 4, as for you, Daniel, obscure the matters and seal the book until the time of the end. I would suggest this is the Aleph concept. The Aleph, again, is the plan, all these thoughts and everything gathered up, becoming this one thing. There's a verse, out of the abundance of the heart, it's this, out of the abundance, the mouth speaks. I see this as an Aleph concept. The thousand is also the one. That's an Aleph concept. From the many, it becomes focused into this one issue. So, take all the matters and all the concepts and obscure them into what? Well, if the Aleph is the architect and the Bet is the house, basically, and whatever was gathered is put into the Bet. See, the Bet essentially contains all the other letters. The Aleph contains them all, the Bet contains all those, the Gimel contains all those, the Dalet contains all those. That's another concept. But the point is, something is in the Bet. I would suggest that this phrase here is the Bet phrase. The Gimel phrase is the 2 minutes. The next phrase is the Gimel phrase. Now, if you, 10 minutes, okay, we'll go as quick as we can here. If you understand that a Gimel is a camel, it goes back and forth, or it's the path of the camel, it's the fact that the camel is carrying something going back and forth. Then I, Daniel, looked, and behold, two others standing, one on this side of the riverbank, and one on that side of the riverbank. That side of the bank, this is a Gimel. I'm doing a Gimel concept here. I'm looking from this side of the bank to that side of the bank. So I'm suggesting that this is an implication of a Gimel. One said to the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river. Now, this is in my mind's eye, but if I see someone above somehow the waters of the river, who's going to be up there but Yeshua? Who is the man clothed in linen? Clothed in linen, again, linen speaks of righteousness. And who is the man, which is to say Yeshua, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, become incarnate, the man clothed in flesh, who's the only righteous one, has got to be Yeshua, the Tzaddik one. That's a Dalet. Yeshua said, I'm the door. How long until the concealed end? I'm reading through the Tanakh here, so its phrasing is a little different than the other version I was reading. But anyway, how long until the concealed end? He's asking for a revelation. Daniel here, I believe, is asking to say, show me something. How long till this hidden end? He's asking for a hey. So here we're going through a sequence of the letters. So I'm showing you that here in Daniel 12 is the meaning of the alphabet letters. If you understand the covenant and understand the door, you'll understand what's going on here in Daniel chapter 12. Such as to say, this is the hidden thing that Daniel was told to hide when he said, hide the word and seal the book. Okay, anyway. And I heard the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river, Well, that's, he's referring now to the man clothed in linen. Well, that's the same as the door. Yeshua said, I'm the Dalet. So he's regarding himself as this. As he lifted his right hand and his left hand to the heavens. Well, that looks like the Paleo Vav in this motif. And swore by, this says the life source of the world, or in the other version, him who lives forever. Well, who is him who lives forever but him who died and rose again unto living forever, so that we could also see him as the model that we shall live forever in him, but the one Yeshua, the Messiah, who was cut off. That's a Zion. That's the implication of the Zion in this position. That it would be for a time, times and a half. Well, he's now saying, I'll tell you, this is the extent. He's giving a containment. It would be for this. He's designating the surround, the chet. Upon the completion of the fragmenting of the hand of the holy people, all these would be finished. The number tet is the number 9, which means completion. It also is the representation of a basket full and a stamp, a seal. But basically, he's saying that the completion of all this would be, he's telling him, that speaks of tet, which is completion. And I'd heard this, but I did not comprehend it. He didn't have a grasp of it. Daniel was saying, I don't get it. I don't, well, that the grasping hand, you could say, is the yod, the hand that works, the hand that takes hold of. So I said, my Lord, what is the end of these matters? He was saying, I don't get it. Could you give it to me again? Could you make it more clear? Could you hand this to me and explain this to me? He's asking, the open hand, he's asking for a kaf. There's an implication of the next letter. And he said, go, Daniel. Now, the authoritative command to go was like the shepherd's staff, the lamed. For the matters are obscured and sealed. He's now declaring, these matters are just obscured and sealed. By his authority, he's saying, these are obscured and sealed until the time of the end. It's lamed. For they shall be, this Tanakh speaks completely differently, but the other version says, many shall be cleansed and made white and refined. This says, they will be elucidated and clarified. Now, he's here referring to the words in the Tanakh. The same verse written in English is referring to people. And many shall be made white and cleansed, which is to say laundered and cleansed. This says elucidated and clarified, which is to say, well, mem speaks of people, or it could be maybe the words, the many words. But the point is, what is muddled will be made clean, whether it's people, whether it's words. The point is, it's a mem concept here. Refined by many people, or many shall be refined, which is to say a noon concept, which is to say strengthened, equipped, made better, processed, refined. Going on to the Samech. And the wicked will act wickedly. So the Samech concept is that we're supposed to do justly. What is wickedness? To not do justly. So here, this is the antithesis of this, but it's still a Samech concept. For the wicked shall do wickedly. And then the next phrase, having to do with the ayin, having to do with understanding, but none of the wicked shall understand. But the wise shall understand. Well, who are the wise? Those with the mind of Yeshua. Those who listen to him, talk to him, walk with him, regard his ways. From the time of the daily offering was removed, or it says from that, another version says, from the time that which is eternal is taken away. Well, what's eternal? The righteousness of Yeshua, which is all of this. From the time that is taken away, it says, and the moot abomination, or the abomination of desolation, put in place. He's now talking about something usurping the position of righteousness. From the time that happens, so now he's talking about the Zadok, and now he's giving an overview, is 1,335 years. So the Kuf position is giving an overview of the length of the duration of time. And then it goes into the rest position. Praiseworthy is he who waits. The other version says the one who overcomes and waits for the 1,335 years. How do we how do we become the overcomer? How do we receive this praiseworthiness? How do we become the resh man? It's talking about the resh man here. By waiting and overcoming. Yeshua said, watch and pray. As for you, Daniel, go your way, go to your end. Go about your business till the end of your life. This is the last we hear of Daniel. Daniel lived his life. Daniel did his whatever he was going to do. And he says, carry on. Exist. Be. Go your way. What's the sheen? The heart of the matter. The heart essence of the Almighty. His nurturing, his consuming fire, his inner being. But you, Daniel, just carry out, burn out the rest of your life until your end. Then arise, you will rest. Then arise at the end of days to your portion. Tav, the sign of the covenant, we will rise. We will confront the day of judgment, the day of atonement. We will give account for our life. What we have here is in this sequence of Daniel 12, all the meanings of the letters laid out with every sentence, similar to what I ran through in the book of Revelation. And then we come back to this and say, the one we didn't talk about is the bet. That's what this says here. So this is the word for this phrase in the bet position, which is the seed, you might say, that everything was put into from the Aleph concept. So what is hidden here? And if this is until the time of the end, that these words would be hidden and sealed, and if just now, if this is what this is, and if this reveals the time of the end, then the next thing Daniel said is very important. And the question is, what is that? Because if this is now being revealed, then this is now pertinent for us to comprehend, to make use of for our strength, for our betterment, as a gift given to us by him who said to hide it until those guys need it, which is us now, supposedly, perhaps. Until the time of the end. Well, let's not worry for the moment about translating what these words mean, because this is a different way to read it. Kuf Zadik. Kuf Zadik. After this, righteousness. The view that he was shown from behind the head, Yeshua. His righteousness. What is his righteousness? Do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with your Elohim. How do you do that? With the impartation of the life that you get after you've regarded his instructions, that you've got after you've determined to come into the kingdom and be shaped by him, by seeing him revealed, because you have come to the blood of Yeshua who was poured out for you so that you could enter into the kingdom regarding his name. After this, this is what we are to do right here. What are we to do? This is a statement, a command for our regard. The ornament that he gives us is his righteousness. He gives us this ornament of these white robes of righteousness that he imparts to us, that he gives us. But it's with the expectation of what we ought to do and be from the heart. Not just say, well, I got the robe, I'll go do whatever I want. This is what we should want. The point is, it's a statement of what we ought to do. When he showed Moses the back of his head, he said his name, Yahweh, Yahweh. Merciful and kind and compassionate and gracious and forgiving. That's the view from the back of the head, which is the view of who Yeshua is. So another way to read this is what he showed Moses is the righteousness of Yeshua. The righteousness of Yeshua is the Zadok is also the fishuk, which means caught, which means our desires, and that's what we should be doing, our desires to be doing his righteousness. And anyway, to go on with this. This word here, Vav is the number for man, double seal, teeth, destruction, the hand that causes destruction, whether it's the Almighty's hand or just a hand. Destruction is coming. The man who's behind the double seal is safe from the destruction that's coming. The double seal, book of Revelation says, we're safe, we will be overcomers if we keep the commandments of the covenant and the testimony of Yeshua. Noah will put in the ark, he's sealed from the inside, the hand of the Almighty sealed from the outside. This double seal, this double reference of what we must have in the book of Revelation is the only thing that will keep us safe in the coming calamity, which is soon to be upon us, according to the prophetic scriptures of these days. What's next? Messiah's house, Messiah's bride, which he has established, is brought forth, is birthed, is exposed. Yeshua said, I go to prepare a place for you, and I'm coming back. I will take you there. I will give it to you with the, mm-hmm. it's the time of the wedding. The fact of the matter is, Yeshua's bride is the one who is regarding his righteousness, the one who is regarding his righteousness and his ways, that is his bride, that he has established, that he has made, is also brought forth. So whether it's speaking of the New Jerusalem, like we were just talking about in Revelation 21, or whether it's talking about which is the place that he's prepared, or whether it's us, his people, that he has prepared as his bride, the point is that which he has prepared, his body, his house, that he has established, is brought forth. That's what we have to look forward to, the expectation through the travail, on the other side of the travail of this time that's coming, that we're safe from. Anyway, connecting the covenant, the hooking together of the covenant between the Messiah and his bride, his wife, his body, is revealed. Another way to read these letters. Well, what's the connecting of the covenant? Well, that's like the marriage. The marriage, according to the Torah on Mount Sinai, when Yahweh spoke the covenant, it was a marriage relationship between himself and the house of Israel. And he talks about it in other places where there's these two women, the house of Israel and the house of Yehuda, who were his wife, that he had to divorce. One in the house of Israel, he divorced. The other one, he didn't, but they were behaving waywardly. And so here's a question to ponder. Who's the bride of Christ? Who's the wife of Yeshua? Who is this one that he divorced and the one he didn't? Did he have two? There's quite a bit there to discuss. Anyway, the point is, we've got to wrap this up. We're almost out of time. The marriage of Yeshua and the bride is revealed. The revelation of the access to understanding the covenant. This is the word da'at, which is knowledge. He will reveal the imparted knowledge. The imparted knowledge, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, was the tree of the da'at of good and evil, that Adam and Eve, Adam and Hua, grasped and took, that they were told not to. But here he restores unto his people what he wanted to give them, that Adam and Hua blew it for us, that we've all blown it for ourselves. He will now give to us that thing which they ought not to have tried to usurp. This has to do with revealed is Yeshua, the door, who is the deep fountain of understanding of the covenant. Once we are married to him, the knowing of him which is imparted is the depth of his reality given to us who are of him, who are in him, who have received him.